Hello, hi friend, welcome back to the channel. This video is the continuation of Terraform series. So far in this series, we have seen different things like how to create a resource group, how to cross-reference variables, how to use a state in a remote Azure storage account. And in this video, we are going to look at how to create a virtual machine. Now, when you start learning about cloud computing, I think this is like the hello world of cloud computing where you create either a Windows machine or a Linux virtual machine, and then you connect to that. So we are going to start by looking at this and see how to create a Windows virtual machine and how to make some minor modifications to that. So let's get started. The first thing we need is to create some network related resources because we need these things to connect to the Windows virtual machine. And I'm going to use some of the things that we have done in the past. So if you have not seen the earlier videos, I suggest that you go back and have a look at those videos because we are going to use some of those concepts in this particular video. So the network resources I'm going to create is, I will start with creating a virtual network and we will cross-reference some of the names here, like the virtual network name, which comes from the variables. And the location and the resource group name. All these are defined as part of the Terraform variables file. Then we create a subnet, which will host the part of the network or virtual network. So these are all the software defined network resources we are going to use, along with a public IP. This can be used to access the virtual machine from a remote machine or from our laptop. And then we create a network security group rules or NSG rules, so that we can remotely connect or we can have a RDP session to that Windows virtual machine. And we open the port 3389 on that. Now, this is similar to what you would do in the graphical user interface where you would select which is the VNet, which is the subnet. And if you want to enable any of these network security rules. And finally, we will attach that particular NSG rule to the network interface by creating a network interface card or NIC, and then we will have the location of that NIC and the resource group cross-reference from our resource group itself. And in the IP configuration, we will assign the private and the public IP to this particular NIC. So those are all the network resources we need for creating a virtual machine. And then we have this Windows VM.tf file, which defines the attributes or the required attributes for creating a Windows virtual machine. So we use the Azure RM Windows virtual machine as the resource type and give a logical name as TF Windows VM to this. And the other things are specified. Some of them, they come from the variables and some are hard coded. If you prefer, you can pick all these names or you can assign all these names, like the name of the VM, which is defined as TF Dev Windows VM. This also can come from the variables file. For the ease of use, I've kept them in the local file here. We also define what is the size or the SKU that we are going to use for this particular VM. Now, when it comes to Microsoft Azure, if we go on to the Windows VM sizes, or virtual machine sizes, there are different series of options or there are different SKUs, and these are categorized into different series, like D series, which is general purpose compute. Then we have the E series, which is optimized for in-memory type of applications. And then we have F series, G series, and various other series of virtual machines based on the specification or specific type of workload that they can run. So we will start with the general purpose VM, which is a standard DS1 V2. And we will assign admin username and password. This again, for the purpose of the demo, I have hard coded this here. Please do not do this in production. You can pick these values from environment variable. And in one of the future videos, we can explore how to do that. And then finally, we assign the network interface card to the NIC that we had created earlier in the network.tf Terraform file. We also attach a disk and we want to create a Microsoft Windows Server 2016 Data Center Edition. So with that, we can go and run these commands on the command line, We will start by doing a Terraform init to initialize the provider. And then we will go and run the Terraform plan command to plan the resources. So here we see that 7 new resources would be added, and since we don't have any of the existing resources, all these would be created as new resources. Let's go and apply this Terraform apply, and we will do a auto approval so that we don't have to say yes every time a resource has to be created. Now this will take few seconds or some time to provision the resources. So again, it shows us on the screen what resources would be provisioned, and then it starts to create those depending on the hierarchy or depending on the dependencies that they have on one another. So here we can see it started with the resource group, then it goes ahead and creates the VNet, then it creates the public IP, then it creates the security group, and because Terraform has that intelligence, it is able to identify which resource has to be created first before it can be assigned to the dependent resource. Finally, we are at the stage where it's going to create a Windows VM. Now let's go into the Azure portal and have a quick look at this. I'm going to look at the resource groups first because we are creating a new resource group here. And when I go on to the second page, we can see TF resource group 08. Which is the resource group for this particular video. Now in this, we can find the network interface card, NIC. There is the NSG, public IP, Windows VM. There is also the disk and the VNet, which have been created. And all these are created in the Australia Southeast location. One thing which I like about the resource group is we can click on this resource visualizer, and it gives us a nice visualization of the different resources and how they are interlinked to one another. So here again, in the visual representation, we can see there is a Windows VM. We can even do some quick actions like start, restart, and view the properties of that. We have the network security group. The disk is attached to the VM. Same way, the network interface card is attached to the VM. And then we have the public IP and the VNet. So I feel this representation or this visualization is quite helpful in understanding the different resources which are part of a resource group. Now let's go into the properties of this particular virtual machine in the overview and click on this Windows VM here. And we can see that the size is what we specified, DS1 V2, one virtual CPU with 3.5 gigabits of or gigabytes GB of memory. It has been assigned a public IP and various other default settings, which we did not specify as part of our Terraform file, but they have been enabled because of the defaults which are provided by Terraform. So with that, we know that the virtual machine has been created and it's not in the ready state yet. We need to give it some time so that we can connect to it. And we can use this connect option. There are two options to connect to the Windows VM, one via the secure way using a Bastion host, or we can connect using the RDP because we have exposed that 3389 port. We can click on the connect here and download the remote desktop file, RDP file to our machine, and we can connect to the public IP. I would leave that as an exercise for the viewers to give it a try. Now, one thing I want to try out here is we have this size specified and I want to change the size to something else to see what is the impact of making a change in Terraform file for the Windows VM definition. And I'm going to use a standard G1 type of a SKU here. Imagine a situation where instead of general purpose VM, I want to use a memory optimized storage and virtual machine, which is, let's say, for a large SQL database or NoSQL database or ERP, SAP, that kind of a workload. I want to change that from a general purpose to this very storage optimized type of virtual machine. So that is where I'm going to use the standard G1 as the SKU type. And If I go and apply this again now, or instead of applying directly, we can even see what would be the changes by running Terraform plan here to see what change would happen if I try to make this modification to the SKU type of the VM. So here we can see that Terraform will perform the following actions, and it says that the TF Windows VM will be updated in place, and it would make the size change. When we see the tilde here, it means the size of the VM would be changed from the current DS1 V2 to standard G1. And let's go and apply this. Now, the benefit of doing this is the whole purpose of using something like infrastructure as code, tools like Terraform, Ansible, and others, which allow us to define the state of the system in a descriptive manner, is that we can trace the changes to our infrastructure. Now, imagine that someone went ahead and made this change, and assuming that your organization has a process which can link this change back to the requirement, you would be able to find out over a period of time why things changed in your infrastructure and what was the reason why this particular change was done. So that is the benefit of using this infrastructure as code. We can trace any changes that happen to our infrastructure by putting this in the source code management system. And because we have this ability to use the plan command, we can do like a dry run to understand if resources would be changed in place, like in this case for a change to the SKU of the VM, or they would be destroyed and recreated. Now, in some cases, it might not be possible to make that change in place. So if we were to apply those changes, it might so happen that the resource is recreated. And again, in future, we might be able to see that as an example in one of the future videos. So now when I go back and see the output here of the apply command, apply is complete. Let's go into the Azure portal and check the details of that particular VM again. Let's refresh the details for this Windows VM. And if I go back into the overview, here we can see the size has changed to G1, and it is now having 2 virtual CPUs and 28 GB of RAM. The other properties, they remain the same because we did not modify any of those. So the public IP and the private IP, which was assigned to this VM, they continue to remain the same. Only the size has been changed. So what we saw in this particular video was, it is quite easy to create a Windows virtual machine and also to update the properties of that. Now, there are various other properties which I've not covered as part of this video, and I would put a link to this Azure Windows Virtual Machine page or the doc on the Terraform registry, where you can find all the other supported properties using which you can update or you can create a Windows Virtual Machine with whatever required attributes you need from the Terraform file or Terraform code. I hope that you found this useful. What you can do next is to play around with these properties, and do let me know in the comments if you found this useful. Please hit the like button, subscribe to my channel, and keep me posted if there is any specific video you would like me to do on this particular channel. Thanks for watching this. Until next time, code with passion and strive for excellence.